Hey, so exciting news, my advanced framer course is finally out. In the course, we built this website from start to finish. To celebrate the launch, the video you're about to watch is the entire first lesson, where we build the nav and this flyout menu component. Now that may seem simple, but there's tons of gnarly little tricks going on here. Down below, there should be a remix link to this starter file you can use to follow along with the lesson. It also has the completed nav component in case you get stuck. If you want to check out the course, go to advancedframer.com. So that's enough waffling. Hope you enjoyed the lesson. Alright, so welcome to lesson one. The first thing we're going to be doing is building the dtax nav. Now, the nav is kind of interesting because it does this cool little transition from sort of static to sticky. It also has this menu flyout thing going on. So the blog and the pricing pages have some content in them. And if we look at the mobile version, we have this little overlay that's triggered when I hit the hamburger menu. Let's jump over to Figma and I'll take you through how some of this stuff works. The first thing we're going to be building is this static to sticky transition we just saw. So the way this effect works is we have our static variant of the nav component, and that's positioned sticky to the viewport with an offset of 16. And then beneath it, we have a div called nav trigger, and that's absolutely positioned 24 pixels from the top of the page. And then as our viewport scrolls down and it hits that nav trigger, it triggers the variant transition from static to scrolled. Now the reason these two elements have slightly different offsets is for this effect. I scroll just a little bit and it looks like the nav hasn't really moved. And that's because of the difference between those two offsets. It's only 8 pixels, but it makes it look like it transitions from static to sticky. Okay, so let's jump over to Framer and start building it. Now, I've already set up the nav component. I actually just copied it over from the Figma file. You can just do something like this, Figma to Framer, and copy that over. It'll copy all the effects, like the drop shadows and the blurs and everything. One thing I did was I just replaced all the text elements with the text button component that you have in your starter file. It has a bunch of helpers in it, so it has like a hover state when you hover over it, and it also has like a link, and you can change between text and chevron and active and all of these states. So that's all I've done. The first thing we need to do is select this, rename it, I'm going to call it scrolled, and then we're going to give it a variant. So let's just select this one, and we're going to call it static. And for now, all I'm going to do is change this to be red. And I'm going to hop back into the main page and I'm going to draw a frame right here. And I'm going to make this absolute. I'm going to give it an offset of 24 from the top. I'm going to make it the whole width of the page. It doesn't really matter. I'm going to give it roughly the same height as the nav. But again, doesn't really matter. Then I'm just going to make sure that it sits underneath the nav. But the reason we can't see the nav is because I need to set it to position sticky. And now I'm going to give that an offset of 16. Nice. They should be offset different amounts, but I've got padding over here, which I'm just going to remove. And there you go. Okay, now we need to give this a scroll section ID. We're going to call it nav trigger. And then all we need to do is select the nav. We're going to put it in static first, and then we're going to add an effect scroll variant. We're going to say section in view. We're going to make sure it triggers when the viewport is at the top. We want replay, yes. Nav trigger is our section, and we're going to transition to scrolled. Cool. So now if I preview this, as I get down to that, it transitions. So that bit's pretty simple. Now we just need to clean up our static variant. So if I double click on this, and I'm going to reset the overrides, and then I'm going to show you the wrong way to do this. So you're probably going to be tempted to just remove all of the styling from this variant. So remove the background blur, remove all of it. But if I preview this, you'll notice that as we get down to that point, there's like a flash of gray as it transitions between the two. And that's because this state has no background color, but this one does. And when Framer adds a background color, it picks presumably black or something, and then animates from that color to our background color, which is why you get this weird flash, and you can see the border animates in weirdly too. So to fix that, let's go back to our component, our static variant, and we're going to reset the overrides. And this time, we're going to animate the opacity of everything. So we're just going to set the opacity of all of these colors to be 0. That includes the shadows. So we go into the shadows and we make these 0. And the same for background blur, we want to make that 0. Now when we preview it, you can see the transition is much nicer. Now, I just want to tweak this so that this variant's padding has slightly more padding on the top and the bottom than the other variant. If I just set the opacity of this layer to 0 and preview it, you can see that it just pops in slightly more naturally with that effect. Okay, cool. So the next thing we need to do is the flyout menu transition. And the way this works is we actually have to sort of like hide it in its start position. So you see that its opacity will be set to 0, it won't accept pointer events. And then as a mouse enters one of these areas, we transition to the flyout menu open variant, which has it in the correct space. And we also need to add some slots in this so that we can add content. You might be thinking, why do we need to animate it quite like this? And the answer is, if we didn't, it would just sort of pop in almost instantly and it feels very unnatural. So let's go get started. Pop back into our Framer file, and the first thing we're going to do is add another variant. So we're just going to create a normal variant. We're going to call this flyout open. Now we need to do some restructuring. We want the flyout menu we're going to add to be a child of this flyout component, but we don't want it to be in this nav. If I pop over to the finished file, you'll see what I mean. So if I select this, we have the nav as a child of this main element, and then the flyout menu also as a child. To do that, we need to select the primary variant, right click, copy style, and then we're going to wrap these children in a stack, and we're going to paste the style onto that stack. Now we need to just remove the style from the parent. So we go here, make the padding 0, remove all of this. It doesn't even need a corner radius. And make sure to remove the background blur. Sometimes Framer freaks out. Whenever this sort of thing happens, it's best to just reload the tab. Okay, there we go. And now we just pop in here, rename this columns to nav, and we're gonna set this to fill, and we're gonna set this to fit. And it should look how it looked before. But obviously these changes have affected the static variant. So if we just pop over here and we remove all of these, and then select the nav itself, and we have to redo the steps we just did. So if I do this quickly. Okay, cool, so we're back to square one. Now we can add our flyout menu. So select our flyout open variant, and we're just gonna hit F and add a frame anywhere around here, and we're gonna drag it, make sure it's not a child of that nav section. And then we're gonna set its position to absolute. We're gonna make sure that it's in the middle. We're going to set its width to relative and make it 100. And then for now, we're just going to set some arbitrary height on it and just drag it sort of into place. We want it to be 8 pixels from that nav, so around about there. And then we want to pin it to the top, not the bottom. So that means this element will always be 82 pixels from the top of the nav. Now we also want it to share the style of the nav, so we're going to copy style, and then we're going to paste style. Everything looks pretty good except for those corners. They look huge, so I'm just going to make them 32. Okay, and now we just need to add a transition. So select our blog button, and you'll see we have mouse enter already set up over here. And that's because this component has mouse enter set up as an event inside of it. So if I just select this, new transition, see mouse enter, I can't actually change that. And then we're going to select the flyout open variant. Now when we preview this, I hover over the blog, we get a flyout menu, which is cool. But notice how it doesn't go away. And if we refresh that, notice how there's that blue flash and it just sort of pops in from the wrong position. Let's go fix both of those things. So the first thing we need to do is set an interaction on the whole flyout open variant. So we're going to say on mouse leave, set variant scrolled. The next step is to get rid of that blue color. And that's happening because the flyout menu in here has a blue fill on it. The best way to get rid of that is to select our frame, and we're going to say update primary. And you can see that's made the flyout menu visible in this variant, which is not what we want. But that's fine because we're going to put the flyout menu in its star position. Remember, we want it to transition from somewhere up here down to there. So let's do that by just pushing the up arrow, getting it roughly in place, something like that. And I'm going to make it a little bit smaller too. And then we're going to override those changes in this child variant. So I'm going to say 250 height and 82 from the top. Perfect. Now we want to set this opacity to 0, but we're going to have to override that in the child variant. So we do opacity 1 there. And it's also good practice to make sure that this hidden one isn't accepting any pointer events. So if we go here, select pointer events, none. And then we want to make sure that this is pointer events auto. So now when we preview this, you see how nice that transition is. Okay, so let's add different content for the blog and pricing. We're going to drag in this menu content component. And you can see we can switch between pricing or blog. Okay, cool. So now if we preview this, we'll see that we get some blog content and we get some pricing content. But there's a bug. Notice that when I go from the menu to the flyout menu with my mouse, if I spend too long on this little gap between the two, it collapses the menu. And that's because as far as frame is concerned, the mouse has left this component, so it triggers the animation back to the original variant. The fix is actually pretty simple. All we want to do is add a little bit of bottom padding. So we're going to make this 8, and we're going to do the same for this one, so 8. That's because 8 is the distance in pixels that this is away from that nab. So now if we select this variant and zoom right in, you can see that there is no gap between this main element and the flyout menu. So if I go preview that, now we have no issue. Okay, so the last thing we need to do is make this responsive. On desktop, we're fine. On tablet, we're starting to get an issue. What I want is for this padding to sort of shrink depending on the width. And that's a little bit trickier to do than you might think, but there's a hack to it. So if I go in here and I select our menu items frame, what I'm going to do is set a max width. I'm going to set that to fixed. I'm going to make it something like 560. I'm just going to guess for now. And then I'm going to set a min width. And I'm going to set something like 480. And now I'm going to change this from fit to fill. And I'm going to change it from start to space between. And essentially what I've done is told it to adjust the spacing between the items between 480 and 560. The spacing will be adjusted according to how wide it is. If we take a look at the tablet view, you can see it hasn't exactly worked. And that's because these menu items are set to fill, but these buttons are set to fit. So these get to take up the whole width. So what we need to do is set these buttons to fill and align them to the end of their container. And now when we go back, the spacing between the items is sort of dependent on how much width it has. But obviously that doesn't work on mobile, so we'll need to create a hamburger menu for the mobile version. Okay, so the first thing to do is select our primary, add variant. We're going to change the width down to match our mobile breakpoint, which is 390. Rename this to phone scrolled. And now we're going to do the same with our static variant. So we're going to add another one. I'm going to set its width to 390, not 3900. And we're going to rename it. Okay, so let's go in here and let's turn off all of the things we don't want to see on mobile. We're going to turn off all the buttons to select our menu items, and we're going to remove this min width and max width. And then I'm just going to grab an icon from Feather Icons. We're just going to drag that in. Okay, and now we're going to do the same exact thing for the static version. Now remember, all variants in Framer share all of their layers. So instead of adding a new menu icon, I can just find the one that's hidden from this variant and turn it on. Okay, now we just need to make one more variant, and we're going to make the expanded version. So I'm going to set its height to roughly sort of like an iPhone height. I'm just going to call it Phone Expanded. I'm going to set this to align to the top. I'm going to turn all these text buttons back on, and I'm going to make them wrap this way. Okay, so I just spent some time finessing that layout. If you want to check out how it works, you can take a closer look at this layout in the DTAX template. But for now, we need to go make it work. So we hop over to our phone breakpoint, select our nav, and select phone static. And now we just need to change the scroll effect so it goes from phone static to phone scrolled. Now we want to make it so that pressing this hamburger menu triggers an overlay. And to do that, we need to go back into our component. We're going to select our hamburger icon and create a new event. We're going to call this event toggle menu. Cool. And we're going to do the same for this one. We're going to make sure that it's set to toggle menu. And the same for this. This should be a close. Change that. And we're going to add the same toggle menu event. So now when we select our nav component, we have access to this toggle menu overlay. If we select this, it'll bring us into overlay mode. I'm going to change the background to gray 50, and I'm going to set the Z index to, I'm going to make it like 5. And then I'm going to drag in the nav component, and I'm going to change the variant to be phone expanded. Now obviously its width is set to 1200, which is not what we want. So we want to change the width to be 100%, and we want to make the height 100% too. So you might be tempted to use 100VH here, but let me quickly show you why you shouldn't do that. So 100VH will take up 100% of the viewport height, but on mobile browsers they have this address bar area. And sometimes this is shown, sometimes this is hidden. And 100VH will make the overlay exactly the same size as the viewport, even if this is showing, which will push the buttons down below the viewport edge. Instead, we want to use 100% because it takes up 100% of the available space. Now, there is a CSS unit called DVH, but we don't have access to it in Framer. So we stick with 100% for now. Now, to close the overlay, all we have to do is select the toggle menu event we created and select close overlay. So if we preview that on mobile, you can see that we get that nice static to sticky transition, and we can also open the menu by clicking the hamburger and closing it, clicking the X. And that's pretty much it for the nav component. We've covered a lot of ground in this lesson, so time to take a break. And the next lesson will be building this feature carousel, which sort of animates between screenshots.